Javed, we'll be speaking about Habib Tanvir today. You knew him all his life, all your life, right? You knew him from the time that you were a child. What are your earliest theatre memories of Habib Tanvir?
In early days, I was in Raipur. And Habib Sahab theatre did not travel at that time, and it started traveling later. For most part of my early childhood, Habib Sahab was either in Bombay or abroad. When he came back, he was in Delhi. We were in touch. We used to get reports of him. We used to get letters from him. And, you know, because Habib Sahab's name was Habib Tanvir, Habib Ahmad Khan. His name was not Pyare. But for some strange reason, we had several mamas, and he was the only mama who was called Pyare Mama. I don't know why he was so Pyara, but we all called him. I must have started him because I was the eldest of the sibling. So everybody called him Pyare Mama. And so much so that our children also called him Pyare Mama. And although he was not their mama, he was their dada. But everybody called him Pyare Mama. And any time a letter arrived from him, it was like the Eid day. I mean, anything from him was very eagerly looked forward to by his sisters, by his mother, and by us. His father was kind of, you know, he was there in the very early days, then he died. So I don't know how excited he used to get whenever Habib Sahab came. But he was more when I, in my childhood, as well as I can remember, the earliest memories of my Nana. He was more given to religion and so on and so forth. So he was kind of, he had renounced all these other things.
He was a Hafiz, wasn't he?
He was a Hafiz. He was a Hafiz. A very quiet kind of a man. He was an old Pathan, long beard, and that's how I remember him. He was just not bothered. He was not bothered about the things around him, and everybody was fooding him all the time. He was a typical, innocent, simpleton of an Afghan. I remember everybody in the family used to go watch movies. All women would go and watch movies and tell him that we are going for some kind of katha. And he believed it. So poor child was left steeping there. So anyway, but my nani and my mother and my mausi, they all were all the time talking about Habib Sahab, and he was that kind of legend. And this was before he became a legend in the theatre world, before he had achieved anything. He was just loved so much. So that's my earliest memories of him.
But theatre memories, tell me something about theatre memories.
Theatre memories, all I remember, the earliest thing that I did was his interest in Chhattisgarhi folk songs. And I was in school at that time. So he would go and collect songs. Listen to songs. There was a distant cousin of ours who was not a village person, in fact. They were very urban. They also lived in Raipur, but they had closer connection with the countryside because they were landlords and they used to have people coming in from the villages and going to their own village and so on. So he knew a number of folk songs, and my uncle would call him over and listen to songs from him. So that's about it, and I did not know what use he was going to make of these songs. It was only when I came to Delhi that, and I stayed with him in Western Extension area. I was a student, I was doing my undergraduate work, and I was staying with him. And that time, he and Monica were already married. They started in a theatre.
And so this is when, in the early 60s?
Yeah, I came to Delhi in 62.
62.
And the Naya Theatre was founded in 59. So this was a period of struggle for them. And even then, I was still very young and not really very keen on theatre, not a very avid student of theatre or any such thing. So I didn't know much about it. And I used to find sometimes his productions very embarrassing because, not because the productions were bad or any such thing. I mean, I was in no position to really say good or bad about the production. Very few people used to come to see them. They used to do these plays in Fine Arts Theatre. And there was one gentleman who was a friend of theirs, who was a member of the Naya Theatre, whatever the team that they had, the company that they had. And he used to set the box office. Nobody came to buy tickets. Nobody came to buy tickets. 5 aadmi, 6 aadmi, 10 aadmi, 20 aadmi. Aise log natak dekhte the. And he was, this was his period of experimentation and so on. So he was doing all kinds of things. He was not just doing Chhattisgarhi folk, he was also doing other kinds of production. He tried, I remember, for some years, he was trying out various temple rituals. So there used to be these people would come and they'd, you know, on stage, music, song, and dance, and then it's all temple music and temple singing. Suddenly, one woman, one leading actor, Mala usually, I remember Mala doing that, and Fidabai also did it. Suddenly, you'll have what they call Devi Charjati Thiuspe. So, Bal, Bal, Koke, wild, you know, it will be all over the place. Rolling on the floor and, you know, doing all kinds of things, jumping and so on. So it's very wild and very scary for a young person like me. It was just out of space. It was a bit scary also. I said, how can this be theater? And a lot of people had that problem with him. But he was only trying these things. So these are my earliest memories of his theater. And so, it was some time before I began to realize what it is. I mean, this was also something to do not with my exposure to his work, but to when I had done some study in theatre, I had read about theatre, what theatre is all about. I read plays, not his plays alone, but other things. So I was slightly better equipped intellectually to handle the experience and appreciate what he was doing.
As I understand it, Habib Tanvir didn't speak Chhattisgarhi at home, did he?
That's in very family, interesting, yeah.
And so if that's the case, then where does this love for Chhattisgarhi come from? Where does this connection with the rural culture come from? What do you think triggered it off?
I have written about it somewhere. That's a very interesting thing. We were urban family. My immediate family and Habib's immediate family had no direct connection with the countryside. But Habib's uncles, you know, the extended family, there were a lot of people who were all zamindars and, you know, landlords and so on. So that was one connection. Another thing was, like I said somewhere, even in my childhood, and would be much more so in Habib's childhood, even in my childhood, you know, demarcation between city called Raipur, the town, it was not even a city, a small town called Raipur, and the countryside was absolutely, you know, very fluid. You went out on a walk and before you know it, you're in the countryside. So it was that close. Also, all the people who came, you know, all the people who work in the house, vendors, because those were not the days of your shopping malls and plazas and big stores and so on, so forth, no phones. People used to come, mostly women, sometimes men, with fruit, eggs, milk, dahi, all kinds of things. They were all just sold. They bring you to your house. And over the years, a relationship used to develop between families and these people, because the same woman would come, dahi leke aati hai, uska naam bhi pata hai, are Chandra aaj nahi aayi, to aayi aaj itne dinon ke baad aa rahi ho kya, aur phir uske baad wo apni kahani batati hai, uski family mein kya ho raha. So that kind of close connection between the women of the family and these people who came from the villages. And during the special tihar, like the raut, ek hota hai hamare yahan kuch jo gwale hote hain, unka ek period hota hai when they have they go to house to house dancing. Chanda
Chandra,
he uses that raut dance now. So raut would come and dance, perform in our courtyards, and of course you had to give them something at the end of it. So that was the kind of very close nexus through these people. And everybody in the family, my mother spoke very fluent Chhattisgarhi, my father didn't. And Habib Saab, ever since I have known him, he has had some smattering of Chhattisgarhi, and increasingly became much more fluent. I don't know when he picked it up and how much of it he picked up right in childhood, I don't know. Because he says somewhere that he used to go to the villages with his uncles, some uncle of his, and listen to songs. He used to like some of the song, the tune or whatever, would, because he had, you know, he liked singing and he had a voice, singing voice. So he did that. He memorized some of those songs. But his real interest in the folk, you know, music and so on, developed after his, I suspect, strongly, and he says it so too, after his involvement with IPTA. Because that's where he realized that he has to go back to people, and he already had this background, he had some basic interest, and you know, he remembered where he had come from. So going back to people's traditions and, culture, cultural form, meant going back to Chhattisgarh for him. And that's how it started, you know.
If you think about it, it is true that he has the IPTA influence.
Mm-hmm.
It is also true that he goes back to Chhattisgarh and works with Chhattisgarhi actors.
Mm-hmm.
And so therefore the actors also bring with them their language, their forms, etc., etc. And yet, Habib Saab's own theatre is neither the IPTA kind of theatre, nor is it folk theatre. So how would you think of Habib Saab's own theatre?
Actually, every time I think of Habib Saab never started with any kind of, you know, very clear roadmap. He was interested in theatre. That interest was sharpened and maybe even initiated during the IPTA days. Maybe he was interested before that, I don't know. But during the IPTA days, his interest in folk culture developed during that time. He was trying out everything when he was in Bombay. He tried being a journalist, tried being a radio journalist, he tried films. His purpose was going there to join films. He went, actually he abandoned his studies at Hadigar University. He did not have money to go to Bombay, so he applied for some kind of Navy recruitment thing, and Navy Wallahs used to give you up the fare to Bombay to come for the interview. So that way he got the fare to go to Bombay. He went to Bombay. And he was there for several years. So he tried all these things and increasingly got involved with PWA and IPTA. Then he suddenly, he says, and I have no way of, you know, questioning it or verifying it. I have to take his word for it. He says that he realized at one point that cinema is not the thing for him, that his career is in theater. So he decided to come back to Delhi. And in Delhi, again, it was a period of struggle in the beginning. He worked, you know, with Auntie Gobba's school. He did some plays with small children. He worked with Jamia. And just then in Jamia, because of his IPTA connection, Jamia had some kind of, they were celebrating a centenary of Nazir Akbarabadi. And why Nazir Akbarabadi? Because Akbarabadi was not a communist or a leftist, but he was a people's poet in the 18th century. And that because of the democratic nature of his work, perhaps was the thing what made him so interesting for IPTA. So there was somebody called Athar Parvez, who was a friend of Habib Saab. He was in charge of the Jamia chapter. He invited him to do a play or do something about this. So he decided to do a play and prepared a very small play. And that was the beginning of it. Is increasingly that play became very successful. It was very good. And he, by that time, he was more seriously thinking in terms of theatre, I suppose. And he came in contact with Begum Zaidi, who took him under her wing, and he then applied for a scholarship because there were no theatre training programs in India. So he went, like everybody else went, Ramkathi went, so he also went to Radha, and he didn't like it. Like that, you all, you know, that he didn't like it very much, and he went to Bristol and roamed around. He saw a lot of theatre in Europe, So all that, this is how gradually it developed. He never came into theatre with very clear idea. I mean, he realized that he wanted to do theatre. But, you know, when I look at what he actually, what his theatre actually became, it evolved through a very long period of relentless exploration and experimentation. You know, he tried out things, he had rejected things, he did new things, and finally arrived at the, he never had a formula beforehand. And like he describes it himself, how he did it and how he realized his mistakes and he corrected them and so on. So that's how this, I see theater thing developing. I don't think he ever had any very clear formula or roadmap or any kind of any specific source that he's drawing upon. Not Ipta, like you said. Not Ipta, not your Bharat Muni or Aristotle or Brecht or anything. I mean, even at the latest date, when he knew about these people, he had read, he had seen Bertolt Brecht, he had spent time in Berlin Ensemble, he talked to them, he'd seen his plays. He never used any of these as his role model or so, in a conscious way. I mean, somewhere these things influenced.
He soaked it up.
Yeah, exactly. I mean,
he soaked
also,
it up. And
yeah,
then
soaked it up. Absolutely. Yeah.
It came out in his own expression.
Yeah, exactly.
But it wasn't any one of these things at any
point. Yeah, it was not a conscious emulation of them, any of these people, or any of these sources. I mean, I always had problem with whenever Habib Tanvir tried to explain some of the things that his theatre was doing in terms of Natya Shastra. I mean, I have a big problem with Natya Shastra thing, actually. I remember once GPD agreed with me completely once we were in a seminar, and I said, I had a problem because people kept quoting Natya. I said, so how can you just keep talking about a thing which was written hundreds of years ago? I mean, after all, the world has changed. Things have to change. It may have relevance, but it doesn't have that much of a relevance. You can't use it in the Bible. So, he worked like that. I mean, that was all in the course of argument. He used the Natya Shastra to say that, look at this. But he understood Natya Shastra or classical form of Indian theatre through the folk form. And he realized that folk and the classical are not really that different. All the Natya Shastri and what? No, Shastra Dharmi and the Loka Dharmi, kind of distinction hai. It's not that hard and fast. I mean, there's lots there that you have in folk tradition, which is similar, like he said, you know, there are no unities and so on. It's basically the same aesthetics. But that aesthetic, one thing that I felt, and I often told him also, and he agreed, that is not peculiar to India. I mean, even in the Western tradition, if you move away from the classical and, you know, Aristotelian tradition and that kind of learned tradition of drama, the popular forms have been like this, fluid, without unity. Yeah. So that's part of the popular tradition.
And so on.
Yeah, exactly.
Absolutely.
You know, throughout the Middle Ages, when much of it is so neglected and has been lost in the West, so that's why we are fortunate we still had many of these forms, whatever devitalized form they still were around. So Habib Sahib could study them and draw upon them. So basically, that's how he worked. You're right, I mean, he did not consciously work with, tried to reproduce it down thing. But that politics stayed with him, that desire. You know, that way of looking at things in a certain way, in a pro-people way, in a scientific way, in a rational way, that remained with him. And I find it very striking that although he worked with folk, you must have also come across, there's a lot of misconception among people who think that his theater was some kind of some variety of folk drama, which is not. It certainly is not. He always said that, I'm not working with any one tradition or form. I'm working with folk actors. I'm not working with folk forms. They bring their traditions with them. They bring their conventions with them.
Absolutely.
And so on.
And
so,
in fact, if you spoke to the actors themselves, it always struck me how the actors would say that they do Nacha back in the village and they do theatre with Habib
Sahib. Exactly.
And the word that they used to describe what they did with Habib Sahib was theatre.
Yeah, exactly.
So in their own head, it was very clear.
And they learned it hard way.
One was theater.
And what I remember, which was perhaps before your time, is there was a time when these theater, the first 5-6 people who came with them, Lalu Ram and Thakur Ram, Das and so on and so forth, Madan Lal, they had no idea of theater. They had no sense of professional stage, commitment, contract, nothing like that. वो कहते अच्छा वो आ गए थे दिल्ली नाटक करते थे बहुत अच्छा करते थे और उसके बाद होली आई दिवाली है त्यौहार है दे हैव टू गो होम और हार्वेस्टिंग सीजन दे हैव टू गो होम एंड दे डिसअपीयर एंड हबीब साहब सीनिंग इट हबीब साहब यूज्ड टू गो विलेज टू विलेज सर्चिंग फॉर देम उनको पकड़ पकड़ के लेके आते थे कि तुमको मैंने एडवांस दिया तुमने कहा था कि आओगे यू हैव टू कम विद मी एंड यू शुड ड्रैग देम सो ही वाज एब्सोल्युटली राइट आई मीन लिटरली व्हेन ही यूज्ड टू से दैट I've never been running after folk forms, I've been running after folk actors. He actually was running after these actors all the time. So they gradually learned that theatre is something which requires discipline, which is you have a job and you have to be there, there has to be rehearsals. It is not like, you know, Nacha, which is done on occasions, special occasions and so on and so forth. The rest of the time you do your own thing, so my BD ki dukaan chala rahe hain ya kuch aur kar rahe hain ya kuch kar rahe hain. Here you, it needs full, it's a full-time thing. So all that they learned through working with Avita. And another interesting thing was that while they were folk, many of them were completely illiterate, like Mala, even Fida, couldn't even sign their name. Some of them semi-literate, not particularly educated. Avita himself was extremely educated and sophisticated, modern, urban person. And he'd been abroad, he'd been all over the place, he had read so many books. He never tried to just give it all up. It was an interesting, you know, interaction of his modern consciousness, rational consciousness, and the folk of mind and traditions and skills and energies of these actors. And through that intermingling, the theatre was created. And I don't think that again was not something that he had planned before, but in the course, all this developed. This is how it evolved.
There's a way in which when one thinks of Habib Tanvir, you know, there's a way in which his own personality and his own genius kind of tends to overtake everything else. Mm-hmm. And I personally feel that not enough has been written about or not enough due has been given to the people that he worked with. Mm-hmm. In particular, of course, his actors. Mm-hmm. Each one of them was a character, came with a lot of individuality, with a personality, also with great skills and a huge amount of cultural, you know, capital, in a sense.
Yeah.
A whole tradition came with each one of these actors.
Absolutely.
And as well as Monikati, And both of these things, the role of the actors in Habib Tanvir's theatre, not just as actors, but in the shaping of the theatre in some ways, as well as Monikadi's contribution, is not something that is written about or spoken about as much as I think it needs to be. How do you react to this?
It's typical. People don't do it. I mean, usually they just go after the big name and then forget who else was there to all the extras, all the accessories through which that person moved up. I mean, you're absolutely right. I mean, until this person in Bhopal, the lady whose husband used to be in Janasatta, she wrote something about, she interviewed, I think, a couple of actors and wrote about them in Hindi. Then you wrote recently when, I think when
I did interviews with all the actors.
The thing was written individually about these people. I mean, Fida Bhai got Sangeet Natak Academy and there was a bit, some kind of a write-up on her a little bit. Very superficial, very general and so on. I mean, these people, you're absolutely right. I have seen all of them right from the beginning and they're unbelievable, amazing kind of actors, you know. I mean, Thakur Das and Madan Lal and Lalu Ram, all these. Lalu Ram, when he was first brought in, and Habib Sahib used him in Agra Bazaar. he was still working with Begum Saidi, Hindustani theatre. So Begum Saidi was a very resourceful person. She had all these contacts, and she knew Nehru, and she knew everybody, and so on. She was very well connected. So Zakir Hussain or somebody was coming to watch the play, or Nehru was coming. And she was horrified when she saw Lalu Ranjan. Because the whole idea, the whole notion, that stage actor, like a film actor, has to be a glamorous kind of a person. Gora hona chahiye, or dekhne mein sundar hona chahiye. Lalu Ram, a cross-eyed fellow, dark. Or whenever he came on stage, he didn't have any that kind of impressive personality, but remarkable actor, a remarkable singer. That. So, Mukhtiyazadi was the one who was horrified by Habib Sahib's portrait. He knew what he was doing. He knew what he was doing, what he was looking for. He valued their whatever they had to offer to the theatre. But unfortunately, Habib Tanvir was not the kind of guy who would sit down and write and document these things. He never did that, unless he did it in his notes with the likes of it with Nagin in Bhopal. And nobody else did bother to do it either. And you're right, I mean, that should be written about. As far as Monica is concerned, Habib Sahib couldn't have gone for two steps without her. I mean, in all kinds of ways, you know. There is, not only in terms of the kind of creative work he was doing, the practical aspects of it. Although he was also taking care of accounts, and he used to say, my manager bhi hun, accountant bhi hun, director bhi hun, playwright bhi hun, sab kuch bhi hun. But then she was the one who had to be there. And how things fell apart, or began to fall apart after her death, was very clear to me when he first prepared that the first version of Rajarakt. When he came to Bharangam with that production, we had done with Usha Ganguly in Calcutta. And he came here, and you know, it was so shoddy, it was so bad. And Habib Sahib had never ever agreed, except for Jan Natamanch, Safdar ke samay mein jab unhone Motaram ka satyagraha kiya tha. उसके अलावा वो कभी किसी ग्रुप के साथ काम नहीं करते थे. करते थे तो अपने सारे एक्टर्स लेके जाते थे. बाद में उन्होंने श्रीराम सेठा के साथ भी किया एक, पर अपने एक्टर लेके जाते थे. कभी जाकर के पूरा एकदम कहीं बस जाया करें ऐसा नहीं करते थे. दिस टाइम ही एग्रीड टू वर्क विद शगाडलीज ग्रुप. ऑफ कोर्स ही यूज्ड सम ऑफ हिज एक्टर्स आल्सो. ही स्टेड इन कलकत्ता फॉर सेवरल मंथ्स एंड वर्कड विद ऑल ऑफ शगाडलीज एक्टर्स. And this is something that he had never done before, as far as I can remember. And this was one of the reasons for that, was he wanted to go get away from Bhopal. He was, you know, Mami had recently died, and she died suddenly. So he was still not reconciled to that. Also, he was at a loss, because she used to take care of so many things. Including every new idea or theater that he had, he'll run it by her. I remember when he was doing the translation, preparing his Kamdev ka apna, Vasant Ritu ka sapna. So, because Monica also knew Shakespeare, knew the plays, that she did many of the translations, she was helping him with translation. He will do his thing, then they, you know, he'll modify it and so on. That's how they went about it. So her contribution is very seminal and very important, very valuable. Unfortunately, it's not been documented either.
And but in fact, I felt personally that when I saw Visarjan, you're absolutely right, it just did not work. It was shoddily done. It was too unwieldy. It was just falling apart at the seams.
And Usha Ganguly made a very bad thing.
She did. I have to say that, yes. And after the play, I remember the next day, he called and he said to me, because after the show, I went backstage and I met all the actors and I met Habib Sir, but I didn't say anything. So the next day, he called in the morning and he said, Sudhanva, tum natak dekhne aaye the, kuch bola nahi tum. So tell me what you think. And I said to him, Habib Sahib, do you really want to hear what I think? So he said, yes. Ke bahut kharab tha. So bole sahi keh raha hu. Bahut kharab tha. Kyun kharab tha? Kya kharab tha? I said, it was very unwieldy and this is not what one expects from you. It required serious intervention and editing. And you make every script your own. Every play becomes your play. You know, that didn't happen with this. And why didn't it happen? So he said, that's actually very true what you're saying. Two things happened. One is, he said, I got scared of the Bengalis. कि टैगोर के साथ कुछ हम उल्टा सीधा कर देंगे तो बंगाली जो है वो हमसे खफा हो जाएंगे. दूसरा कहने लगे मोनिका नहीं थी. सो यू आर एब्सोल्युटली राइट. द फैक्ट दैट मोनिका द वाज द फर्स्ट लिसनर ऑफ एवरीथिंग दैट ही वाज राइटिंग एंड शी हैड अ वे ऑफ बीइंग एबल टू स्पीक टू हिम एंड ऑफ बीइंग एबल टू इंसिस्ट ऑन कटिंग थिंग्स एंड सो ऑन यू नो.
I mean, all that is very difficult to document, and yet nobody even tried to do that, exactly, unfortunately.
Exactly, and yet, for anyone who worked with them, I worked with them two or three times, and every time it was so noticeable. It was just there all the time. And she sat in on every rehearsal, and she intervened at crucial points, in rehearsal as well as at home when he was writing and so on. So that's there. In fact, the other memory I have of that play is that after that play, the next time I met him, he had a mustache. So I said, Habib Sahib, what happened to you? Why are you growing this mustache? So he said, I'm doing this, I'm going to keep this on till I rectify the play. So that Visarjan ka Rajrakt hua finally. And Rajrakt jo hai, wo,
yeah, that's it. That's it. Habib Tanvir for you, not the one to give up ever.
Yes.
You know, I mean, you're right. That evening, I remember, I was so embarrassed. Embarrassingly bad. And yet, because of respect for Habib Sahib, the hall was that, Kamali was bad, and people kept absolutely quiet. Absolutely. And nobody said anything in the end. He got the ovation and so on.
And the ovation.
But he knew that the play had not worked.
The ovation didn't stop. It was extraordinary. Such a bad production.
Exactly.
The ovation just did not stop because by then he had become a legend. Him and all that he stood for. Which was well deserved.
Absolutely.
Which was
the ovation for Habib Rab's name and his, you know, who he was, rather than for that particular performance and play.
Absolutely. But when one thinks of Habib Sahib and when one thinks of Naya Theatre and so on, that's not the memory that one wants to. One wants to go back to. One wants to go back to the memories of plays like Agra Bazaar, Charandas 2, and so on. Which are the plays that stand out in your memory? I mean, I know there are many, many plays, and each one of them is special in its own way. But which is your favorite? Or which are your favorite?
My favorite plays are basically three or four, which I would love to see again and again. Of course, Charandas is everybody's favorite, is mine too. Mitti Ki Gaadi. I love it for its music.
Absolutely.
And what he had done with it. Absolutely. It's absolutely great play. Very well acted.
Beautifully
done. And it's poetry, much of it is written, most of those poems are written by Niyaz Baba.
Right.
And Nia Hada is able to. Do you remember? Did you ever meet
him?
He was a remarkable person, fascinating guy.
Right, I've heard many
absolutely fascinating person. Right, most of the time drunk, but drunk in a most interesting way. So
I've heard these stories from
Amit Sahib. So Niyaz Baba was able to really fit his work to the Chhattisgarhi tune so beautifully, so well. And there's such lovely tunes from Chhattisgarh that we had got into that play. So that's one aspect of it. It's music I love. And also, you know, it's an interesting play, interestingly done. That's first. That's where he developed that platform and, you know.
I was about to say, the staging was remarkable. I saw the play when I was quite young. my first memory of the play is probably from the early 80s.
Mm-hmm.
And I wasn't so much into theatre. I used to watch theatre, mm-hmm. but I didn't think of myself mm-hmm. as being a theatre
mm-hmm.
You know, person, although I used to act in plays and so on. And I saw that play and I was just blown. I said, oh my God, what can you, how much can you create
yeah.
on a bare stage with one little platform
absolutely.
And with one
absolutely.
You know, cloth going up.
Yeah.
And it just created the temple, the palace, the everything. I mean, the garden, you know.
Yeah,
and so
exactly.
On.
Yeah,
it was amazing.
And that was a play which was for very long in the making in his head.
Right.
He talks about it, how he was traveling in Europe, and he says, I was producing with Tiki Adi throughout.
Throughout.
Is in my mind, on paper. And he says, I could never get it right. I always wondered that this play which is so racy and there's so many things happening and it reads so well, briskly, it moves so briskly in reading. When I try to visualize it on stage, the scenes, there's so many scenes and so on, so I just can't get that speed, I can't get that flow and so on. And finally, he then decided that just give up all that settings and, you know, every time you change the scene and locale and so on, is it just bare stage and let everything work through the dialogue, through the movement. And that's what happened.
Absolutely.
And that's how he arrived at that thing which he used throughout again
yeah,
and again.
Yeah.
It's the same in Charandas show and
absolutely.
So on. And another favorite play of mine is, of course, Agra Bazaar, again, for its poetry, its music, and how he was able to get a play out of what, in very conservative terms, is not really a play. Because it doesn't have a story, the protagonist never appears.
It doesn't have a story, the central character
yeah.
never appears.
It never appears.
There's no love,
and
there's
yes,
no
he
sex,
was able
there's
to
no murder, there's nothing.
Yeah,
you know.
That conflict, the social and the cultural, you know, poles, polarities of that time, he is able to reproduce all that. And the discussion that takes place, the book owner, bookseller shop, about new newspapers coming up and this Fort William College and English education and so on, the changing times, the history of the period, that also gets into it. So it's a very rich play, a very layered kind of a play.
In my
which
view,
it again evolved.
Yeah.
Originally, I don't know how it was, because originally the first version which it done was about 40 minutes or 45 minutes.
This is back in 54.
Yeah, 1954, which I wouldn't
right.
pehli baar kiya tha.
That's right.
So, uske baad phir gradually he just kept adding to it and developing it. And people had problems with it. People said that this is not a natak. Isme to koi plot nahi hai, koi character, ni protagonist nahi hai, kuch nahi hai. And even today, many people just think of it as a musical.
Right.
But it's not just a musical. It's much more than, you know, a play full of music and poetry. It's a play actually saying something very important. In addition to entertaining you with music and songs.
Agra Bazaar, underrated as a play of ideas, actually.
Yeah.
There's a way in which just the poetry and the songs and the staging of it is so rich that the people sometimes tend to miss the fact that it's actually, what it does is that it dramatizes the conflict between ideas.
Yeah.
That's
absolutely.
All there is.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know, there's no
yeah.
conflict between real people there.
Yeah.
It's a conflict of ideas.
And does it so nicely, so subtly, and absolutely dramatically.
Quite
like,
good.
For example, that the lovely scene where this young fellow, which is played by our friend, the boy who is called to sing, and he sings the Aziz Ghazal, which that old man, the Tazkira Nabis, the big Dariwala, scholar of Urdu literature, who everybody looks up to, obviously a man with clout in the literary scene. The bookseller also kind of keeps pandering to him. For his entertainment, this boy is asked to sing, and he sings Nazir Ghazal. And nobody knows that this is Nazir Ghazal until he comes to the last verse, what is in Urdu Ghazal called the Maqta. Where his pen name appeared, and this man gets up and walks off in a huff. And then the bookseller also shouts at the boy, kya hai, aapne sara maza kharab kar diya, aapne socha tha, wo khush honge, tab ye aap ye kya, bhago yahan se, and so on. And then the patangwala says, yaar, tum yahan ho, yahan pe sunao. Yahan pe tum shayari pe jaan dene, chhidakne walon ki dukaan pe baithe, unke nahi, jo जो पोएट्री की तिजारत करते हैं, दुकानदारी करते हैं. आई मीन वेरी इंटरेस्टिंगली टू ड्रामेटिक नोक जोक के थ्रू पूरा इज क्रिएटेड दिस कॉन्फ्लिक्ट बिटवीन एलिटिस्ट नॉर्म्स ऑफ लिटरेचर एंड द मोर पॉपुलर ट्रेडिशन. एंड दैट अगेन इज द इप्टाइन्फ्लुएंस. आई मीन I don't know how much of it was consciously done, but it was fresh from IPTA at that time also. It was first production was done for IPTA. So IPTA influence, it may not be easy to quantify, to put it down in very concrete terms, but it's very much there.
It's very much there. Habib Tanvir
could not have been what he is. He became without IPTA, but he could not have been what he became also without many other things as well. I mean, it's not just only IPTA.
Quite right. The other play that I found fascinating, unfortunately I saw it only once when I was really young, is Bahadur Coloring. My memory of it is, of course, Fida Bhai. She was extraordinary in the play. And it's a play with a very modern theme. Not something that you didn't really expect something like that. Why that should be the case, I'm not sure, but you didn't expect it, you know. And I don't have a very good memory of the details of the play, but I have an impression of the play. And I remember sort of coming out of the play feeling, wow, what was that? It moved me, it hit me hard. I wonder, what your memory is like of that?
My memory of Bahadur Kalani, Sudhanva, to tell you the truth, is the weakest. Why?
Really?
Because I was abroad at that time when it was first done. I have seen a production of it, performance, and she said that we have, although I don't remember it very clearly. But I have seen a production, I don't know whether it was Fida Bhai, must have been with Fida Bhai. I have heard a lot about the play through my mother and my aunts and so on, Woods had seen it.
Right.
And they found it fascinating that, you know, the whole story is so gripping.
It is.
So interesting. And my familiarity with it is through reading and through what Habib Shah himself has described about how he came across that story.
That's right.
And how there is a place near Dogagar where there are so many little things which are supposed to be, you know,
connected to
the story. He actually wanted it to be ASI to take it up. Durul Hasan was the Minister of Education, and he said, somewhere he has said in an interview with Anjan Katyal or someone, that I approached him and told him, "Kisko kuch karo, ASI should do something about this, it's valuable treasure and heritage." So he did not seem to particularly. I don't know. Maybe Anurag Hasan was more cooperative. But this is my memory of it. This interview that he had given to Anjum. So those are the sources through which I became aware. It is, and you are right. It's a very modern story. It's a very unusual kind of story.
It is.
You know, it's
and the theme of incest and so on.
I
mean, for me, I think it was the first time that I saw the theme of incest being played out, not just on stage.
Yeah,
I think in any. I don't think I'd seen even a film on it.
Exactly.
I was just a teenager.
Yeah. In many ways, very different from other plays of his. It just stands on its own entirely. But he has done all kinds of plays, you know, I mean, like I don't know what originally, initially fascinated him to Stefan Zweig's story, The Eyes of My Brother, and then he created the Dekhra Hai Nain. So that kind of philosophical, you know, orientation, so he did plays like that, he did Bahadur.
But I remember the writing of that play, by the way. Because this play he wrote in the late 80s when he was in Ber Sarai.
Yeah, in Ber Sarai.
And because we had just done Moteram Ka Satyagraha with him, I had started frequenting the house and so on, would sit in on rehearsals and so on. So he said to me, "Do you know this story?" I said, "No, I don't know it." He said, "Can you get it for me?" Because I had written a... he said that he had written a draft of the play many, many years ago. and had lost it. So he wanted to read the story again in order to write it afresh. I wasn't able to get, you know, this is in the pre-internet, pre-Google days. So I had to literally hunt for a physical copy from somewhere. I went to libraries and so on. Didn't find it. And he said, well, it doesn't matter. I remember something of it. Let me write it. And then he wrote the first draft of the play. And just as he was more than halfway through, I found the book that had the story. So I went to him and I said, you know, here's the story. He said, now I don't want to read it. Because now the play is taking shape in my head. So he did not read it. And finally, he read it only after he had finished writing the first draft. And he was very glad that he did not read it because he had made it completely his own. Once again. And I think very little of the original story actually sort of is there in the play itself. He really makes it his own.
Absolutely.
The overall idea is the same, but it really is his own play.
No, that's true. He did all kinds of things in all kinds of plays. And coming back to Ipta again, now there's another aspect of another kind of theater that he continued to do, which was what I call the activist kind of theater, like Jamadare, which became Poga Pandit, or Sadak, or even Herma. You know, it just takes up a very poignant kind of an issue, social, political, economic, and then does it. The way he goes about it is very interesting. For example, I find the story of how Sadak, I'm sure you know it, he must have told you too, how Sadak came into being. He said that he was, perhaps somebody must have suggested that he has to do a play on development. He got his group together, and as was his practice, he told them that, look,
it was a commission play for literacy.
Acha, okay.
For the literacy campaign.
Okay.
It was commissioned by them.
Okay.
And so he kept workshopping with the actors
So he says कि आपको विकास पे नाटक करना है तो कुछ तैयार करो तो वो improvisation के method से करते थे तो उन्होंने through किया he always gave the initiative idea something so he started playing around इतने कि हमको विकास चाहिए हमारे सड़क नहीं है हमारे यहाँ पानी नहीं है बिजली नहीं है after 5-7 days he says यार ये बहुत boring नहीं है तो सब ने कहा कि हाँ बहुत boring तो कहते ऐसे कहते उलट देते हैं कहते हमको सड़क नहीं चाहिए and then that's how the play was came into being and it's such a delightful play and it says so much about you know development which is anti people development which is pro corporate development and so on I mean it's a politically so
important the end is reminiscent of Brecht and so
on exactly so these plays of his
also Manglu Didi I used to love Manglu Didi because Manglu Didi again was something that he turned upside down.
Upside down.
He instead of when asked to do a play on women's reproductive health, he made the man pregnant. And then it just became a comedy. It was so funny and so on. So he was really
during
really
the '70s. Were you here? I don't know. You must have been very young at that time. During this Bangladesh war liberation. He did a number of plays, Kustiya Ka Chaprasi and something else. And again, drawing upon certain typical traditional Nacha skits, like there was a skit called Chaprasi. He drew upon that and he prepared a comedy skit called Kustiya Ka Chaprasi. So he did a couple of plays for that. So he remained politically engaged as well in a very activist way. So it is not as if he... I mean, he may not be doing consciously copying Ipta, but he was doing that kind of theatre too.
Quite right.
I mean, he also made a mistake. I mean, he got himself into controversy with Indira Lok Sabha, for example. But his reason for that was purely anti-Janasangh. Because he wanted to support Subhadra Joshi against, he wanted Janasangh to be defeated in that election, I remember. So he did this play.
Would you agree with the view that Habib Tanvir, while he remained political through his life, actually got a kind of a second wind of radicalism in the late 80s. That's when he once again became even more radical
than before.
At a time that people would normally have thought you know, now is the time for him to retire, to rest on his laurels, and, you know, etc. In the late 80s, I felt there was a change. It had to do, of course, with the change of the country, on the whole, etc. And maybe I'm being subjective because I was so closely associated with all of that. But I really felt that one of the turning points was Safdar's killing. And the fact that he had just worked with Safdar and Natimanj just that year, literally 1988, we did the play. 1st of January 89, Safdar was killed. And I remember the rage that Habib Saab felt at that time. He was angry. And soon after that, this was also the time that the Babri Masjid, the anti-Babri Masjid campaign was sort of gathering steam. In 1990 was the Rath Yatra and so on. And through that whole period, he became, to my mind at least, I'm not sure if I have an objective.
You're absolutely right.
But I think he became more and more radical as the condition in the country started to sort of become more alarming.
You're so polarized because of that. Yes. I mean, even those who are until then, you know, very quiet and, you know, maybe left-wing otherwise, but then in a quietest way, they started taking sides and coming out and sticking their necks out. So you're absolutely right. I mean, that is, and Safdar's death and the way he was attacked and killed had an immense impact on him for sure. I mean, he was very fond of Safdar. He was quite, I mean, I was not here when that happened. I was again abroad. And I'm sure it's somewhere also held in the sign of, because he never had actually gone away from it. I mean, that my reading is that even the 70s and so on, when he was doing in the Lok Sabha, then he got into the Rajya Sabha, he was all kinds of controversy. He's got co-opted, he's become Congress man, and this and that, the other. This was, two things were happening there. One, because of all this controversy, he was not a politician. He was not the kind of guy who will start, you know, a polemical debate with his opponents who are attacking him for doing whatever, there's wrong politics and so on. He had come from a certain background. He remained largely in his mind, as far as I could see, remained largely CPI kind of a person. When the split took place, he did not go to CPM or ML or anything. He was not very well aware of that either, कि वो क्यों split हो रहे हैं, क्या क्या positions हैं. So he was not that kind of doctrinaire, very well informed kind of communist or any such thing, but he was generally a left wing person. He remained that. Another thing that was happening to him 70s was, this was a period of struggle for him. He was still exploring. He was still trying to find his feet in theater. He was still trying to, he knew what he wanted in theater. I mean, that's, when I say that he did not have a roadmap, I feel that he knew what he wanted and he did not know how to get there.
Quite right.
So he was still exploring how to get what he wanted. A theater, like he says that he had learned to realize in Europe itself, when it had gone there in the 50s, that it has to be a theater which is modern and yet very close to the traditional,
absolutely,
indigenous traditions. And which should be really specifically Indian kind of modern theater, not something which copies, you know, Stanislavski or this or that, the other. This was a period of, so that was preoccupying him so completely. And then suddenly came this Safdar thing, and then Babri Masjid, and, you know, Advani's Rath Yatra, which, I mean, he, though, his old Marxist background somewhere must have militated against Safdar, because he remained a very staunch, in that way, anti-right-wing person.
Absolutely.
Throughout.
And then, of course, in the early 2000s, the attack on Iraq and so on, that also moved.
Yeah,
the international situation was also something that never,
absolutely,
he was aware of it, and he responded to it and so on. We approached him once to write a song for us on Bush and Blair. So he wrote a lovely little song for us for one of our plays. Bush ka matlab jhaadi.
Bush, I have not read that before. What is
Bush ka matlab jhaadi. Blair ka matlab shor. Shor ka matlab raar. Jhaadi ke piche shikar. The one kind of blind spot that I felt was there in his theatre was really to do with the gender issue. Although women characters appear in his plays, and he had, you know, Fida Bhai as an actress. So therefore, at the time that she was there, active, all of his plays had a very strong woman character, and she was magnificent. But in some ways, I always felt that there was no gender politics as such.
No, he was not. He was quite innocent of it, actually. I know. I remember once talking about it with GPT, and GPT said that he was very generous and kind to Habib Saab. He was very, because he once wanted to start smoking, smoking pipe. He wanted to be like Habib Saab, so the role model. So he said, look, and GPT said this, and this man, Sisinda, that you can't expect everything from one person. I mean, there will be contradictions. There are contradictions sometimes, but you have to learn to take, you know, it along with all the good things that the person is doing. So he has that problem. I have always been aware of it. He did not really, you know, the new awareness about gender, he did not have that. And Mami did not have it either.
No, she didn't.
And in certain ways, Monica was more conservative than even Habib Saab. It was like that. But I agree with you. I mean, he was quite innocent of this political gender and its various aspects and its dimensions and its meaning and its implications in society. In a general humanist way, but more than that, he did not understand.
If one looks at his entire career and the kind of theatre that he created, it seems to me that it's over. Meaning that there will never be another like Habib Tanvir. And I'm not saying this in a sense of trying to paint him like some, you know, genius and so on. That's not the point I'm trying to make. The point I'm trying to make is really this, that given the fact that India itself has changed so much, given the fact that our rural context has changed so much, our folk forms have changed so much and so on, to have somebody do that kind of theatre today is virtually impossible to think of. Even Habib Tanvir in his later years found it really hard to get the sort of actors that he got in the early years. The first and the second sort of generation of actors that he had were really fine actors, singers, dancers, you know, musicians and so on. But his later actors, the people who came in the 90s and in the 2000s, were really not a patch on
them. No, you're right. I mean, that is true. That became increasingly because he often used to rue the fact that, you know, cinema and television and homogenizing culture so much, influence all over the place. And we can see that Deepak, for example, after he fell out with Habib Saab and he started a group of his own, had brought a production to Parangam once. I don't know whether it's right.
No, I didn't see.
I mean, he had brought a production which was in Chhattisgarh, full of filmy kind of music and scenes.
Right.
And Deepak, who is such a remarkable actor.
Amazing actor.
You know. So, that was happening, it is happening. The problem only was that Habib Saab was not able to historicize it enough. Because this is, to my mind, inevitable. You know, folk forms and traditions, although we value them as they existed, cannot be preserved in a museum or in some kind of an incubator or whatever, you know, just to perpetuate them. I mean, they are socially produced, historically produced, and history changes, society changes. They have to change. Things do change. And culture will change, cultural forms will change, cultural modes will change. And you cannot continue to lament the fact, kya tha, kya ho gaya. So that tendency Habib Sahab had, but he also, in actual practice of it, he was able to take, he did what was the most scientific and rational way of doing it. Use the energies and skills of these people rather than resurrecting the form.
Right.
His approach was not, like I've said somewhere, not antiquarian or revivalist approach. He just took these energies and created another kind of theater which is based upon these things and yet is very modern, very urban, very contemporary in its way. Another thing, with, I mean, just thinking aloud from what you said, you cannot, I mean, this is what how things have changed, but then otherwise also to think, sometimes even I perhaps, or maybe you also, in our weak moments, we think, Habib Sahab ne kisi ko apne jaise chhoda nahi, train nahi kiya, so to continue that way. Habib Sahab belonged to an age. The world has changed. We don't need another Habib Sahab
now. No, we don't.
What we need, another person like him who will take this age by the scruff of its neck and then do something about it and come up with theater. It doesn't have to be like Habib Sahab play theater. It will be different kind of theater. So you cannot have continue to reproduce Habib Sahab generation after another. That will be very stupid and very, you know, ahistorical kind of thing to do. So both things are true, you know what I mean? You cannot have another Habib Sahab and you cannot have that kind of situation from where his actors had come. Things have changed.
In about 7 years' time, we'll be celebrating his centenary. It seems strange to think of it like that. But, you know, it's just 7 years away now. And so just to conclude this conversation, what would be your thoughts about what still makes Habib Tanvir, in one sense, the conversation we've had has really spoken about it. But in a short and pithy way, what would you say is the relevance of the work that he did for our times?
Very good question. A very difficult question to answer. That's exactly what we were talking about just now. That, I mean, you know, the kind of work that Sampada is doing, unfortunately, we don't have enough of that kind of work. It would be very important to archive Habib Sahab's work, and if we had really a good documentation and, you know, complete this thing of it, people, subsequent generations could look at it and learn something from it. Relevance cannot be entirely in terms of, you know, one thing or another. Like Habib Sahab's own approach to folk forms, folk tradition that we talk about. He took the energies and he did not come with that kind of mind, I'm going to use these actors, unke energies, unke skill ko istamal karunga. He just started working with those actors. He was so impressed by the actor. He started working with them and gradually evolves it into a certain form of theatre. So, in that kind of, you know, indirect ways, subsequent theatre can learn from the experience of Naya theatre and of Habib Tanvir's work. Not necessarily by imitating him or necessarily following him or trying to go back to folk actors and bring them from Chhattisgarh or wherever and then create another group like that. But in that kind of way, how to find a theater which says something to us about our age and our times and our problems and concerns, but which also draws upon the forms and rhythms and, you know, the things that we have known traditionally as our own from earlier time. So something like that, I mean, that kind of thing, that perhaps is the most relevant thing that you, that I can think of for us today, Habib Sahab's work.
Well, thank you, Javed. It's as always, it's been such a pleasure talking to you, and in particular speaking about Habib Sahab and Monika Di and Naya Theatre and all the actors, it's been such a joy. Thank you so much.